Today on Leaf by Leaf, The Atlas by William T. Volman. This is a collection of William T. Volman's globetrotting adventures from the early 80s up to 1994, and includes vignettes from, but not limited to, California, Nebraska, Oregon, New York, Boston, Canada, Germany, Madagascar, Bosnia, Cambodia, Thailand, France, India, Australia, Egypt, Mexico, and Hawaii. Do not think of this as a travelogue or a memoir in the conventional sense, though. This is an invitation to explore the world very much through Volman's eyes, which means something very unique, with the added bonus of his addictive, hypnotic aesthetic. His first book, You Bright and Risen Angels, which I have reviewed on this channel and will link below, was published in 1987. And his most recent, The Lucky Star, was published this year. 33 years of published writing, which has often demanded more than one publisher at a time. He has written in just about every form: novels, story collections, essays, journalism, book reviews, book introductions, and afterwards. This is one of the reasons I even bought Dirty Snow to begin with. There's an afterword by William T. Volman. Newspaper articles, and a decades-long meditation on violence that became what is still his magnum opus, the 7-volume Rising Up and Rising Down, published by McSweeney's, and in a single volume abridged form by Echo. I will get my hands on that 7-volume McSweeney's by the end of this year or early next. In Rising Up and Rising Down, he sought to establish a moral calculus for the justification of violence. No small feat indeed, but this showcases the enormous intellectual power of William T. Volman. He is without question an inexhaustible reader, intrepid explorer, and perhaps our most hard-working living writer. There is a 2004 Volman reader called Expelled from Eden, yet The Atlas could well be a Volman reader in itself. It contains a taste of nearly every piece of his writing, before and after. In fact, a handful of its contents were previously published, some restored to their desired state. It may just be the best book with which to start for anyone new to the author. We get the recurring theme of unrequited love and a woman's company as obtainable only through economical commodification that informs many of the narratives from his prostitution trilogy. The fortune teller's episode even nods back to that prophetic style of You Bright and Risen Angels, which I still maintain is something that almost stands outside of his entire repertoire. It's so different from everything he would do subsequently that you almost cannot believe it's the same author. The germination of his trenchant journalism and his ecstatic, visionary style is on full display in The Atlas. But perhaps most striking is the breadth of his experiences he has had within about 2 decades, and the fact that he was and is still alive to tell about it. The final page of this book could easily have appropriated the verse from Job that Melville chooses to close his own masterwork: "And I only am escaped alone to tell thee." There is no denying the mystique of William T. Volman, and I recommend Conversations with William T. Volman, edited by Daniel Lukes, as a great introduction to the man behind the work. Here is an excerpt from my upcoming review of this book in Rain Taxi Review of Books. William T. Volman won a scholarship to Deep Springs College, which solicits applications from high school students whose IQs are in the top 0.5%. He wrote his first novel at night, while working for a software company, sleeping under his desk and subsisting on Three Musketeers. He crossed into Afghanistan in 1982 to join the Mujahideen in a quixotic blunder. He almost died alone in the North Magnetic Pole. He developed repetitive strain syndrome from 16-hour days spent typing his manuscript about Jesuit missions in New France. That would, of course, be his second entry in the Seven Dreams septology, Fathers and Crows, which I have also reviewed on this channel and will link below. He smuggled a Thai sex slave to safety while on assignment for Spin magazine. He is intensely private, eschewing the internet and email. His phone has been tapped and his mail has been opened without consent, due to the Patriot Act, he suspects. That snippet leaves out many things, of course, including the fact that he was a Unabomber suspect, with an FBI file at least 785 pages long. According to Carolyn Kellogg's Los Angeles Times article, to get his FBI file, access to his NSA file still pending, it took Volman a Freedom of Information request, an appeal, and a lawsuit. Officials reviewed 785 pages, then released just 294 pages to him, to Volman. The rest are still secret. This also leaves out the event that has haunted him all his life, the accidental drowning of his little sister under his watch. He has often talked of this tragedy in interviews and even in his fiction. You'll find that Volman is always present in many forms throughout his work. But the episode in the Atlas entitled Under the Grass may be his most poignant and effective translation of this singular incident across his entire oeuvre. In short, he is a person who has been many places and seen many things, some beautiful, most not. He is obsessed with the other, and this curiosity leads him to places that most of us dare not go. At the same time, he has a true gift for writing, and the quality of his prose matches the magnitude of his travels. The Atlas, in one word, would be loneliness, a chronic condition that Volman captures in striking detail. There is a moment between a man and a woman on a plane that will never leave me. Nothing really happens, and yet the two small gestures, one from the man, the other from the woman, are enough to communicate a vast gulf roiling beneath the surface of flesh and bone. This is the thread that runs throughout the travels recounted here. Through his signature immersion in risk and dangerous situations, while somehow maintaining steady observation, like a twist on Ralph Waldo Emerson's all-seeing eyeball, Volman gives us a first-hand look at racism, poverty, prostitution, disease, alcoholism, drug abuse, addiction, love, sex, loneliness, war, suicide, helplessness, hopelessness, and hauntedness across the globe. There is no real analysis offered, as we begin to get in later works like Poor People, video link below, and Writing Toward Everywhere, video link below, and most markedly in his two-volume Carbon Ideologies. Sadly, no link below yet. But Volman does acknowledge his privileged position and resultant moral ambiguity, knowing that the BBC has offered him a ride out of Bosnia in their armored car. He says, "My guilt about being free to leave has built a silence over time that drowned whatever she actually said. Every day I'd have liked to call her and ask, 'Are you still alive? Are you all right?' But of course, no one could call Sarajevo." Unlike the unfortunate subjects of his writing here, Volman is well aware that he is able to leave the situation at any time he pleases. These stories, or perhaps pericopes, are modeled after Kawabata's Palm of the Hand stories and assembled into a thematic palindrome. As Volman explains in a prefatory note, the palindrome is achieved by having the theme of the first story match the theme of the last story, and the theme of the second story match the theme of the penultimate story, and so on. This structure, with its long title essay in the middle of the two palindromic hemispheres, itself resembles an atlas. The concept of an atlas works here on at least three different stages. First, there is the physical production of an atlas from a cartographer, and Volman enjoys perusing such novelties. Remember, he never goes on the internet. His laptop has been airlocked. Second, the concept of the world out there, the external geographical and topographical world outside of myself. And third, the world as it is mapped in our minds. Everywhere we go, we record phenomena that adds to or amends this mental atlas. It is this latter concept that Volman wishes to communicate to us. I had a hideous dream that life was but a show in a dingy theater of stale air. Note that a theater has long been metaphorically associated with our minds. The actors dully or busily traversing an immense map laid out upon a stage. To be sure, this is not a feel-good book. There is a lot in life that is disturbing and depressing, and much of it is in these pages, drawn in vivid, unflinching detail. At times, I nearly felt nauseous at some of the depictions of squalor and drug abuse. As with a lot of Volman's work, there is the controversial preoccupation with prostitution. Not graphic sex, of course. It is more about the ways in which such a lifestyle affects the emotions and attitudes of those involved. Volman once said that he writes so much of prostitution because in that trade, he finds all three things that make life interesting all at once: love, sex, and money. He has also been recorded several times as saying that we are all a culture of prostitutes. He thus offers an open window for those, such as myself, who would otherwise know nothing of these subterranean communities all around us. I read books to learn of the other. Without these types of books, I would only know these worlds and these people through the falsifying glamour of Hollywood. In an early episode, a mother admonishes her child, "Don't you ever try to see things." That charge is exactly what Volman unequivocally disregards. Volman is a master of mise-en-scene, deftly picking out just the right details to set atmosphere and communicate deep meaning. Having published The Ice Shirt, Fathers and Crows, and The Rifles, by the time of this book, the striking prose poetry of the Seven Dreams heptology, with its preoccupation of the interplay between landscape and humanity, adorns his fluid journalistic voice. There is a character here loosely associated with Volman, one epithet of whom is "he who traveled and watched." But at times the "I" or the "he" becomes something of a chimera. After the title essay, in which the character reflects on all of his travels while going westward on a train through Canada, which is also among the best of Volman's prose to date, the second hemisphere of the Atlas becomes more mystical and dreamlike, as with Reincarnations of a Murderer. He writes one episode from Limbo, the only episode from a location typically not on an atlas. He writes of the Angel of Death as it makes its way around the globe, and in Outside and Inside, which is perhaps the highest achievement in terms of imaginative writing, an injured woman merges with the pages of a book a man has just bought and then haunts him thereafter. We also get a glimpse at his more post-2000 journalistic voice in The Street of Stairs. In the end, you will be breathless and question how one man could write with such range. Here are some excerpts to get a sense of the book's flavor. After 3 or 4 days, I no longer felt a naked tenderness at the back of my head where I imagined a sniper taking aim. That's an example of one of Volman's simple sentences, with just the right words to impart the feeling of his vulnerability. This particular passage comes from a scene in his Sarajevo roadside incident. On assignment for Spin magazine, the violence in Bosnia took his two companions' lives right in front of his eyes. "And I don't understand why there must be money to live." Another telling detail from one of the poor souls recorded here. A simple statement, but with profound implications. And again, with these poor souls near Mexico City. In a sense, the people had a desperate kind of freedom. Nothing was theirs, and so they could never lose it. In one sentence, he captures the mise-en-scene in Thailand. People interflitted on the narrow sidewalks beneath hanging sausages and roasted birds. And again, in a brothel in Germany. He felt as if the blonde from Mannheim had led him into the womb of a ruby grapefruit. And again, at a watering hole in Nebraska. At the Bohemian Cafe, where they sold ceramic bottles of Jim Beam shaped and painted like Czech girls, and the waitresses in traditional dress were themselves shaped like bottles, bearing magnificent quantities of platters on their brawny arms. Food traveled to and fro according to the same laws, in a union of love and shame, leaving the restaurant inside people's bellies, rolling past the neon beer lights of bars in the Czech section, entering the little houses in rows, becoming flesh, then dirt at last, dusty tan dirt under the blue-green blotches of trees. Often in uncomfortable situations during his travels, Volman yet maintained his sardonic humor. "The mosquitoes weren't too bad. They only bit my eyelids, earlobes, cheeks, knees, buttocks, wrists, hands, and ankles a few times." Here, Volman is at his best, selecting the perfect appositives to convey real emotion. One would have to have a strange disposition to read this and not feel anything. "She lit the rock and breathed in, even though the glass tube had been broken so short that it burned her lips and tongue when the rock was only half cooked. She breathed in because when she was 18, her first husband had brought a 2x4 smashing down on the crown of her head. And after that, she'd never had very good balance. That was 22 years ago now, and one of her daughters, she'd been very little then, had said, "Mama, don't ever worry about falling, because I'll always be next to you, and if I see you start to go down, I'll throw myself right down on the sidewalk so you can fall on me." It made her cry sometimes to remember that. Her daughter didn't walk beside her anymore, and so she smoked crack. The title essay is, again, a masterclass in descriptive writing. His pyrotechnics here are at full tilt. Trees as woolly as German participles, pale green, and all the two-story white houses. Yellow flowers, maybe dandelion or mustard. He couldn't tell because the train was going so fast now. Like wet stars in the grass. A brown creek. A ferny forest not yet overthrown. A scudding lake with sailboats on it and roller skaters around it. Smooth green pebbles under the water. These were the letters constituting Canada. So many souls and countries weighing down his atlas. Eternally, everywhere, everybody. He remembered all the women he loved and waited for, all the friends and hopes like fruits in the compartments of an upslanted tray, brown ochre terraces, mottled walls covered with Arabic writing. Remembered the happiness, blessings that had come and passed away, and he remembered ants in an anthill. Then the train was vibrating across a flatness of dark brownish, greenish grass under the dark slate sky with power towers making tall black skeletons of interlocking triangles and a radio tower flashing like lightning far away under the night's thunderhead. He wandered through sleep that was like the soft, wet grass between birch trees. Again from the Vatican, he remembered snowy double curves of ceiling embellished by golden circles of crowns and angels. From these spheres crossed elaborate wreaths, between whose legs lived paintings of rampant lions, monuments, beautiful and terrifying processions, and the ceilings, Saharas, of whiteness, which separated these entities swarmed with angels. Aphorisms strike out and draw blood from time to time. Wars were by definition processes which strove to make advice obsolete. Hell is anything which continues long enough. Enjoy this passage from Cowbells, which was written in Switzerland. A steep land creaked with sap in the beech green air. Ivy grew up the backs of trees, pretending to help them with lying green vertebrae, as meanwhile it sucked their strength. To live means both to strive like the ivy and to suffer like the trees. Dying unites both these elements in a painful struggle. Did the vegetation feel this? They say that plants and slaves do not feel. Below tolled cowbells like a gamelan, rising through grasshoppers, seed rattlings among the gone strawberries. Delicious green swellings of the mountain, those the ivy could not drain, but cows grazed them down to the thick. The cows scarcely moved, it seemed, but they ate all day, tearing off greenness with big bites. They gnawed more slowly than the lake haze, which, hot and blue-white, like the wrapper of a milk chocolate bar, ate the summit. But of course, what they gnawed on also took longer to grow back. Really, you can just about open this book at random and find yourself slowly becoming strangely enchanted with the world as Volman sees it. And I use enchanted in its original sense. The best way I can sum up this book is to say that there is a tension between beauty and death, which is hard to describe without the metaphor of people and places.